thunder. Precious Lord, hear my cry and keep me safe until the storm passes by.
Till the storm passes over, till the thunder.
Morning. Turn to page 332. Trust and obey. There is no other way. Let's stand together. Sing the first and the third and the last of 332.
We do His good will. He abides.
could sing now. Turn around and shake hands one with another, or smile and wave, whatever you can do. As the pastor comes, then you can be seated.
Man, trust and obey. Good to see you in the house of God tonight, today. We appreciate each one being here. If you're visiting for the first time, lift up your hand, let the usher see you, and bring your card. And then also we need to remind you this evening at 6:30, our service, our evening service. And then on Wednesday night at 7:30, our midweek service. Master Club meets on Wednesday also. Sunday school next Sunday, everybody. We keep on inviting you. Some of you come, some of you don't. But we wish all of you'd come to Sunday school. I believe you'd get a real blessing by doing so. The ladies' prayer circle will be Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. Bring a covered dish and no sweets. Wonder why. Linda Jordan will be speaking to the ladies that night. Our Jubilee coming up, Cody Zorn and Joe Arthur, October 16th through the 21st, 7:30 nightly. You're invited. Invite your friends to come. We're going to have a great time in the Lord. And then Trunk or Treat, October the 26th at 7 o'clock. And we'll have tracts to give to all the children when they come by with their bags to get their candy. And the hot dogs will be served or be sold that night during this time. So if you have a special car, truck, or Jeep, or whatever you'd like to park out here and let us gander, we'd like to look at some of these. And you bring it over if you want to. Christmas comes on Sunday this time. We're going to have our Christmas service on Friday the 23rd, Friday night at 7 o'clock on the 3rd of December. So and we won't be interfering with Christmas. They won't be interfering with us. And then the candidates for baptism, I see you're signing up. And we have a sheet out there for those that want to be baptized. And then those that are going to have their babies dedicated, a sheet for you also to sign. And explanation's on the sheet for you. All right, ushers, you may come. We'll receive the tithes and offerings you give today as the Lord has prospered you. The tithe belongs to the Lord. Amen. Brother Rick, lead us, please.
Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you that on this beautiful Lord's Day, Lord, yes, we've got a church like this we can come to, Lord, just to focus on you for a little while, Lord, and to put away the cares of this world, Lord. We thank you for that privilege, Lord. Help us not to take it for granted, Lord. We thank you for what we felt in Sunday school this morning, Lord, for our lessons, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you just continue to bless, Lord, and help it to grow, Lord. Lord, touch those that are not coming. Lord, give them a burden, Lord, for Sunday school. Be with Brother Wes as he leads it, Lord. Give him strength and vision, Lord. Lord, we thank you for Sammy Jr. and the choir and the musicians this morning. Help them this morning, Lord, as they sing for your glory, Lord. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that even though we are going through storms, Lord, we know, Lord, that you are the calmer of the seas, Lord. I pray, Lord, that if the people are going through storm, you would just speak to them, Lord. Give them the peace, Lord, that only you can do, Lord. Those that are sick, Lord, I pray that you'd touch them in a mighty way, Lord. Heal them according to thy will, Lord. Be with the remainder of this service today, Lord. Be with our pastor, Lord. Strengthen him this morning, Lord. Give him what we stand most in need of hearing. Bless this offering for us in the name of Jesus, we ask. Amen.
Amen.
choir for the good singing this morning. Praise the Lord. All that was good. Amen. I want you to turn to Philippians for a verse of scripture today. Chapter number 1. This is on page 1258 the old Scofield Bible. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 21. Paul said, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. I want to talk about that a little bit right now. This verse speaks of total surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ, that all Christians should be totally surrendered to the Lord. Nothing should come between you and the Lord at all. I mean, there are things to enjoy in this life, but nothing should ever take the place of the Lord. Now, my friend, this verse also speaks of full joy in the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we used to talk about living it up. In other words, I'm just living it up. And they mean in the world. They mean doing the things of the world. Well, that's one way of living it up, all right. But is that all you have, is just living it up? Somebody said, well, you just got one life to live. You better live it up. But you better think about one life is all you got. And, brother, after that, it's eternity. And so you need to be really thinking about eternity if you're not saved. Now, if we fail to surrender everything we have to the Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to be lacking in many other issues in our Christian life. Now, God doesn't call, He doesn't call all people to be a pastor or an evangelist or a missionary or anything like that. He doesn't call everybody to be that specifically, but He calls everybody to be His servant, calls everybody to be saved. You're saved here today because God called you. You didn't get saved on your own. You didn't decide one day, I believe I'll live right. I believe I'll turn over a new leaf. I believe I'll start going to church. No, that's not what you did. If you're really saved, God put a specific call on you by the Holy Ghost, and you came under conviction of the Holy Ghost and received Christ as your Savior. And if you didn't receive Christ, you missed it. You missed it, I'm telling you. And people used to say, you know, in the mill, when I got saved, after living, they'd seen me live before, and then I got saved. And I said, they asked me what happened to me, and I got saved. I got born again. And they'd say, you know, you just got religion. It won't last but about 2 or 3 weeks. You'll be back drinking and cussing, carrying on with the rest of us. But it didn't happen that way, because this time I didn't get religion. I got salvation. I got Jesus in my heart. So some preachers, you know, are afraid to preach on total surrender because they're afraid they'll run their members off. If you start putting, they think it's putting pressure on them. And listen, I'm not preaching to put pressure on anybody. I'm preaching the Word of God, hoping the Holy Spirit would speak to your heart and draw you to do what you need you ought to do. Now, that doesn't mean that everybody in here is backslidden and all that. I'm not talking about that. I'm presenting something to you that God laid on my heart from a very familiar verse of scripture in Philippians chapter 1 here. For instance, some people, they're good, good people. I mean, they are fine. I mean, they're friendly. And they are good friends. And they have money. And they have pleasures. And they have a lot of stuff in this world. I mean, materially speaking, they're well off. But they don't tithe. They don't tithe. Well, something's wrong. And I'll tell you what it is, dogmatically, emphatically, what's wrong? You're not surrendered totally to Christ. For you to live is not Christ. It's something else. Something else is causing you to steal God's money. His tithe belongs to Him. And if you rob God, if you don't tithe, you're robbing God. And that's what Malachi teaches us. They said, how have we robbed you? He said, through tithes and offerings. Now, listen, let me say this. Those offering band, I'm just kind of preaching now. Been here 56 years, coming next month. I ought to have a right to say something, oughtn't I? All right, if everybody in this building, when that plate came by, and you said, I'm not going to give anything. Now, I'm not fussing. I'm preaching now, helping you. If you'll let me help you, if you passed that plate by and said, I'm not going to give. Well, now, what if everybody in here had done the same thing you did? We'd have got no money. All right? These lights would not be on next week. The heat would not come on in the winter. We'd have to shut those doors immediately, because every month we have to have at least $50,000 or $60,000. to pay the bills. All right, if you don't give, how are we going to do that? I don't have that. I can't do that. So it's absolutely necessary that every child of God know his responsibility to tithe, to give 10% of every dime God gives you. You give 10% of that to God. That's his. You say, well, can't God do without it? God can do without everybody. He could come by with one sweep of his bedroom and just wipe every one of us off the map right now and still be God. God's not hurting, but God has made it where we could have a responsible place in ministry and get blessed for it. He said, if you give, I'll give it back. And that God wants us to trust him. We're singing about it, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And so my friend, good friends, good people, loving people, and preachers are saying, well, I can't preach that because I don't want to lose those friends. I'm not going to lose any friend over what I'm preaching today. Now, if I ever lose a person here, it's not going to be because I preach the truth to you, because you're not a friend. If that's your case, you're not really a friend. So listen, my friend, we have lovable people in our church, lovable people, wonderful people, blessed people. I love them with all my heart. But you need to learn to tithe, and that's what I'm here for as God's minister, to let you know what you ought to do. Now do it. Now do it. When that plate passes by, everybody ought to have their tithe ready to put in. Everybody. Paul said upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by and store. All right. So I got Bible to back me up, so I'm going to leave that alone, and I'm going to take that. You know, they say a word for the wise is sufficient. All right. If you're wise, that's all I have to say. But, now listen, my friend, the negligent need to be warned that they are such. They're negligent. And so negligence won't get you what you could get if you were not, if you'd obey God. Now, where did the idea of tithing come from? Did it come from man? No. Did it come from a preacher? No. Did it come from a synod? No. Did it come from some religious organization? No. Where did it come from then? It's got to come from somewhere. Right here in the pages of this book. Abraham tithed to Melchizedek. People say it's under the law. No, it was way before the law ever got here. Abraham tithed. The whole Bible is full of tithe. And God said, a tenth is mine. He said, give me that tenth, the first fruits. We're supposed to do that. And so, my friend, we know that this tithing idea, if you want to call it that, did not come from man or anything that man has to do. It came from God. So it is from God's holy word that we read this truth. Now, preachers are commanded to preach what? The whole counsel of God. That means every word that we preach ought to be out of this book. And we should not shun to preach the whole counsel. If it comes up, God lays it on our heart, we're to preach it. We're not doing it to hurt anybody. We're not doing it to make anybody mad or sad. We're doing it just to try to help everybody to enjoy more of the blessing of God. I'll tell you, the greatest thing in the world is obeying the Lord, just living for God, doing whatever God says. And so, my friend, we have right here that this word, he said it, and I believe it, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Now, this verse speaks volumes to us if we'll look at it very quickly. First of all, it speaks of rest, for me to live. And as I said a while ago, people say, I'm going to live it up. Well, the best living you've ever done is when you live for God. I used to live it up in sin. Thought I was having a good time, and it pleasures of sin for a season. It'll last a little while, but it'll dwane. It'll go away. It didn't satisfy. Not one thing that you and I have ever been involved in sin, that ever satisfied. Never satisfied. You get disgusted with yourself. You get disgusted with sin. You want to get rid of it and don't know how. And you wonder, what in the world am I doing here? And why am I in this stinking world anyhow? And then, praise God, one day, one night, Jesus got a hold of your heart and came into your heart and into your life and saved you by his grace. And hallelujah, now I know why I'm in the world. I've got a good standing before the holy God of heaven, not because I'm a good man, because my Savior is a great Savior. He saved my wretched soul, and I'm happy to report that. And so, my friend, Paul said, for me to live is Christ. Man, I used to be a blasphemer. I used to hate Christians. I used to kill them. I used to throw them in jail. Paul did all of that when he was Saul of Tarsus, and before he was smitten down on the Damascus Road, he was as mean as the devil wanted him to be. But when Jesus got a hold of Paul, Paul got up from there and preached the gospel until he died. And when it came time for him to have his head chopped off on Nero's chopping block, he said, I'm ready. I'm ready. Brother, listen, if you live for God, you'll be ready to die. Whatever calls upon you, and my friend, you're ready for it because the grace of God will flood your soul. So Paul was ready. In Galatians 2:20, he said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. I live. Don't let anybody tell you Sammy Kay's not living. I'm living, hallelujah. I'm living because I'm crucified with Christ. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. In the life which I now live, I live in the flesh. I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Jesus loved you. Jesus loved me and gave himself for us. Now we need to continually praise God for eternal life. You cannot get lost if you try. You can't because you've got eternal life. But listen, are you surrendered? Are you totally surrendered to this great Savior? Now, the assurance of this life brings a peaceful rest to the soul. My soul used to be in a turmoil. I mean a turmoil. Yours probably was too. But now I have perfect rest in my soul because it's saved by the grace of God. In Romans 8:6, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Romans 5:17. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness, shall reign in life by one. The Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the only one you need in order to have this life that God offers in the Bible. John 16:33, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me, Jesus, you might have peace. Hallelujah. In this world, you shall have peace, he said, and shall have, you're going to have tribulation, though, he said, in the same verse. You're going to have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I've overcome the world. No matter what your tribulation is or your trial is today, it can't take you out of his arms. He said, I've overcome for you. And you're going to be mine from now on, no matter what you're going through, no matter what kind of problem or trial you're going through. And listen, my friend, don't let the trials, I don't care how serious they are, don't let them get you out of church. Don't let them get you down. Stay in church. Stay close to God. Keep surrendered to Jesus. He'll work everything out in due time. And if we're mature Christians like we ought to be, we'll be able to handle anything that comes our way. Are you listening to me? Handle anything that comes our way, no matter how dark it is, no matter how severe it is. God's grace is sufficient. Woo, glory. His grace will take us through all of the trials we have, all the tribulations we have. He'll take us through. Now, my friend, the surrendered life does speak of a peace and a rest, but it also speaks of a cleanness and a closeness. And over in John 15:5, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. I agree with that 100%. Without Jesus, I can do nothing. Without Jesus, I can't preach. I can't pray. I can't live for God. I can't live a surrendered life without him helping me. But over in 1 John 1 and verse 3, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. Now, whenever you pray, you're not praying to an idol. You're not praying into the air. You're praying to the true and living God. The Holy Spirit is omnipresent. He's in this room in every nook and corner. He's in every Christian's heart and life and body right now. What, know you not that you're the temple of the Holy Ghost? Your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, of God. You're not your own. You've been bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So the psalmist said in Psalm 151, he said that thou art near, Not way off. God's not way off. Now, God's got a place in heaven. He's got a palace there, got a throne there and all that. But he's with us also in the person of the Holy Ghost, which is the third person of the Trinity. O Lord, he said, thou art close. O Lord, and all thy commandments are true. Not one thing in this Bible a lie, so you can depend on it. Jesus, keep me near the cross is what we ought to all say. There is a precious fountain. Praise God, freed all, a healing stream, and it flows from Calvary's mountain. Without Calvary, we wouldn't have a chance, but with Calvary, we have it. We have eternal life. So, for me to live is Christ. Psalm 61, verse 4, I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. Now, there are wonderful blessings where God performs, and that he does perform on our behalf when we're fully surrendered to him. We have a safe shelter under God's care. He said his wings. Now, that's not a literal chicken wing. Now, I'm talking about his covering. His shelter is over us all the time. We're protected by him. Now, here God is revealed, and he reveals himself as reaching you and me in prayer. And we reach him in prayer. He reaches us in prayer. We talk to him on our knees or wherever, driving down the road, and he's listening to every word we have to say. And here we experience a life of love, of grace, of mercy, and of power. And here we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. How can we partake of such blessings as these? John 15:3. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. So it is real. And it is well. You know, I like to hear them sing, when peace like a river attendeth my way. Yeah, when sorrows like sea billows roll. Hey, whatever the lot, thou hast taught me to say, even so, it is well with my soul. Whatever's in your life today, can't you say right now, under your breath, or out loud, it doesn't matter, it is well with my soul. Is it well with your soul right now? My friend, this is a wonderful, wonderful experience. And even so, it is well with my soul today. My friend, it's fruitful. It is perpetual. And I'm telling you, it is real. Excuse me. Jesus said that he would send the Comforter, the Holy Ghost, that he would be with us how long? Forever. So then, we have these truths given to us right here. And then, we have the supernatural life. It's supernatural. How could Sammy K ever live for God? I know him. And I had people to say that about me. He couldn't be living for God. I've told you many times, some of the boys from Alden and Conestay heard that I was preaching at Simpsonville, and they said, well, it's not the Sammy K we ran around with, but let's go down there and see. A bunch of them drove down, and sure enough, old Sammy K up there in the pulpit preaching. They couldn't believe their eyes. Couldn't believe it. But see, this is a supernatural something man didn't do on his own, something God did for us. So we have a new life now. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, creation. Paul's preaching got the attention of the Athenians there on Mars Hill. They had all those devotions, you know, and then had one ascribed to God, the unknown God. They didn't know who he was, and Paul came along. And the Bible says in verse 19, and they took Paul and said, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things are. You're preaching another God. We want to know what you're talking about. We want you to explain it to us. And of course, the Bible says in Acts 17:21, they spent their time. The Athenians spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Anyway, you know, they like to talk. So they wanted to learn everything they could. Anything new that came along, tell me. I want to know. I want to tell it to somebody else. I guess you'd call them gossipers. I don't know what you'd attribute it to. But anyhow, they like to tell it. They like to hear it. And old Paul had the opportunity to tell them about Jesus. Let me tell you something. I don't care what your idol is. I don't care what your God is. I don't care how many gods you got, they're no good. Destroy them all. and get Jesus in your heart. And that's all in this world you need. That's all you need to go to heaven is the blood of Jesus Christ. Bless his holy name. In Acts chapter 17, verse 28, for in him we live and move and have our being. So we have a new life, but we also have a new environment. He said right here, old things are passed away and all things have become new. Now, that don't mean everything in the world became new. It means everything pertaining to this became new. So we have a new life now. We have a new environment. We are different today, praise God. We have a new life. We have a new friend. Have new friends. We have new habits. Our habits have changed. We have new desires. We have new places to go. Listen, my friend, you remember how it was? You remember how that once we had sinful friends that we fellowship with. Now we have Christian friends. That doesn't mean that we said to those ugly friends, I hate you, get away from me. No, we witnessed to them. Some of them I led to the Lord. Some of them came up here and joined this church and died in this church as members. But we used to have all those bad friends. Now we got good friends. We used to have bad habits, drinking, cursing, running around, all kinds of sinful things. Now we refuse strong drink. We don't drink a drop. I haven't had a drink of whiskey and beer in all these years that I've been saved. Not one drop. I don't want any of it. I hate it. I used to love it. I hate it now. And then, of course, we don't drink anymore. We don't curse anymore. We've got new habits. And we stopped all of this cursing and all of these things that were absolutely ungodly. And then we went from one hell hole to the other. Remember? Couldn't get satisfied. Let's go to the Lawrence Street Cafeteria. Let's go to the Oasis. Let's go to the Moose Home. Let's go to the Country Kitchen. Let's go to the Pink Elf. Hey, you couldn't get satisfied. Went from one hell hole to the other. Now we go to church. Woo! Glory! Hallelujah! We go to church, amen, and we don't have to hop around from place to place trying to find satisfaction. I'm satisfied. I'm satisfied with God's people in God's church, with God's Son, my Savior, my Holy Spirit Comforter. I'm satisfied with what I got right now. I wouldn't go back to all that stuff for this whole wide world. Jesus satisfies. So we are happy. We used to be unhappy. We used to be miserable, but now we're happy and we're not miserable anymore. So we have a new life. We have a new environment. And we have a new enjoyments. Now and forevermore, we'll enjoy the blessings of the Lord. We have a new name over there in Acts chapter 11, verse 36. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. In other words, they were disciples, but they got so much like Jesus Christ, following him and doing his will. People got to saying, those are Christians. Hey, we got a new name. Hey, we are called Christians. Somebody wants to be ashamed of that? Not I. I'm not ashamed of being a Christian. Amen. I wouldn't dodge anybody if they're trying to intimidate me or trying to make me feel down and out because I'm a Christian. Perish the thought. It won't bother me what you do and what you say. I'm saved. I'm a Christian. And I'm glad to say I'm a Christian. And I don't say that boasting in the flesh, saying I'm better than you are. I'm not better than anybody. I'm just better off than some people. Because I've got the real salvation that Jesus gives. New name. Proverbs 22:1, a good name is rather to be chosen than great riches. You say, well, I got all kind of riches, Brother Kay. I got everything you don't have. Don't worry about it. God said my name is more precious than your riches. He said it'd be better, Sammy, to have a good name, a good Christian name, than to have all the riches of this world. So it can designate the entire person, his individuality, and his power. So men are known by their name. Name can mean race. It can mean describing somebody in some particular phase or situation. And Jesus told all of us to rejoice. Why? That our name is written in heaven. So our name is in heaven today, and it cannot be taken out. Listen, we have a new song. We have a new song in Psalm 40, verse 3. He brought me up out of a horrible pit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brought me up, how horrible it was. how it used to be so horrible. I detest it. I tell you, you get to hating yourself, you get to hating everything. And that was horrible. But you know what the blessed Lamb of God did for Sammy Kay and you and me, all of us? He brought us up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay. We were stuck in the miry clay. We couldn't kick loose. We couldn't get out. Woo, y'all, I'm just on the verge of shouting or having a spell or having a heart attack. One, I don't know. And he set me free. He set my feet upon a rock. He's the rock. And established my going. He hath put a new song in my heart. I used to sing love sick blues. Now I sing God is love. The love of God is greater far than anything a man could ever tell or write. The love of God. Yeah, singing those old country songs and things and living like a nut. And now, praise God, we're singing the love of God. And this tells me something. To live for Christ, that's my life. To die would be gain. If you live for Christ, you're not going to lose a thing. If you die, that's the worst thing that could happen to you is death. But that is not going to hurt you because you'll gain when you die. Let's stand to our feet. If anybody here today and you're not saved, you want to get saved, we'll talk to you, pray with you. Do it here at the altar. Go in a room. Go in my office. Whatever. We'll be glad to lead you to the Lord Jesus. And if you're here today, you want to do anything, pray. You can do it right where you are, but you can come to the altar too if you want to. We always invite people to come to the altar if they want to come. Sometimes they come after the benediction. That's fine too. We don't care when you come. Just as long as you get your heart right with the Lord. We're concerned about your soul. And so you just surrender everything to Christ. You'll never be sorry, but trust in his name. We love you, and I didn't mean to hurt anybody in the flesh today, but I meant to let our people know what would make you happy. Happier than you are if you're not doing what God would have you to do. Surrender all to Jesus. Our Father, in the name of Jesus, we love you and thank you for this church. Love you and thank you for every friend of this church, every visitor, every member, every person standing here today. I pray your blessing upon them. I pray that, Lord, our eyes, spiritual eyes, would be wide open. We'll be able to see the truths of God and his word, and that we'll act accordingly. I commit all to thee right now, Father, in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Ghost. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you at 6:30. Everybody come back now, 6:30.